You know, the title of this session is The New World Disorder. So we have a vast canvas before us. I want to explore the idea that this idea, implied by the title, that the world is getting more chaotic, more dangerous, more downright disorderly. And in short, I want to ask whether we are living in the end of days. And let me name the signs, if you like. Trump, Brexit, continuing financial meltdown, the rise of ISIS, climate change. I want to discuss whether what we're seeing at the moment is a kind of retreat from reason, an epic global endarkenment, if you like, the breakdown of global institutions, the re-emergence of the primacy of the nation state, the return of ideological and religious conflict, the limits of capitalism to deliver growth and prosperity. So very modest ambitions for this hour we have ahead of us. And we have a fantastic panel to help us discuss these momentous questions. Most of the audience, I'm sure, will know Zafar Sobhan, the founder and editor-in-chief of the Dhaka Tribune, one of Bangladesh's leading English-language newspapers, a great driver of competition in the newspaper sector.
Thank you.
Here in Bangladesh. Rosamund Urwin is a feisty, witty, and incisive columnist and feature writer for the British newspaper, The Evening Standard. Max Rodenbeck is one of the most experienced correspondents with the hugely successful and influential news magazine, The Economist, which I'm sure you're all regular readers of. Max is a particular expert on the Middle East. He spent most of his career reporting developments in the Middle East. Ben Judah is an expert on Russia, and in particular, the Russian leader, Vladimir Putin. He's the author of a wonderful book on Putin called Fragile Empire. His latest book is on contemporary London, called, appropriately enough, This is London. So who better to discuss the questions we have here? And first off, I'd like to begin by asking our panel, have I missed any of the signs of this impending apocalypse? Zafar, let's start with you.
Thank you, Justin. Well, as I mentioned earlier, I have a somewhat apocalyptic view of the direction the world is taking, but I have to say I think you hit all of the major points. I think when we look at something like Trump's election, which is the most recent sign of the apocalypse, the most recent horseman, if you will, it's, I think, important to understand that it's not an isolated incident or event. I think one needs to look at it in the context of what's happening around the world. I think it needs to be seen in the context of Brexit, in the context of the rise, the power of people like Putin in Russia, Erdogan in Turkey, Modi in India, and I really think that is kind of the direction we're moving. And I think the shorthand we all learned at university about the 20th century was, it was kind of, you know, the shorthand narrative. It was the triumph of liberal democracy over communism and
the end of history.
Fascism, the end of history. And I think now what we're seeing in the 21st century is the breakdown of that old liberal order we've had. And I think that Trump's election absolutely is a harbinger of all of this. And I think it has two impacts. I think it's really going to crumble America from the inside, but I think it's also going to have a tectonic impact on the world outside of America as well.
Okay, Max, I want to come to you next. You know, your perspective. Max is now the South Asia correspondent for The Economist, but previously was in the Middle East. I mean, looking, I'd like to take you back to the Middle East, looking from a perspective of the Middle East. Do you buy this whole global disorder narrative?
Well, the Middle East has been happening, the same disorder has been happening in the Middle East for a bit longer. Maybe the Middle East was actually ahead of the rest of the world in breaking down and collapsing and being miserable. But I slightly disagree with Zafar. I mean, I don't absolutely disagree, because if it all falls apart, I wouldn't be surprised. But and I think, in reference to Fukuyama's end of history and so on, history is definitely back with a vengeance, there's no question. But I would be slightly more cool about it. Because I think, for one thing, we are perhaps overestimating the Trump phenomenon. The more one sees about his incoming team, the more frightening he is. But actually, the power of the presidency in America is relatively limited.
Zafar's point was Trump is just one of the horsemen. You know, Trump is a symbol of a bigger change that's happening.
But I slightly suspect that, I mean, there's a more of a global phenomenon. I think in a way that what's happened is we have this much more interlinked world in which we've all become citizens of a bigger world, you know, instead of simply being, we're all citizens of the world, the entire world. And I think, like a lot of things that happen, changes that happen like that, we are not very good at doing that. I mean, it's a matter of becoming better at occupying, inhabiting a really interconnected world. So I think there are many things that have happened which are due to the fact that, populations, nations, are not very good at acting as global citizens.
So this is a kind of dislocation we feel as we're drawn into a global world.
That's right. In the same way that people are not, I mean, any new technology that comes in is often misused to begin with until people understand how to manage it. And I think the interconnectedness of this sort of digital world is being abused in many ways right now, through the media, et cetera, through polarization, through this sort of trolling, for example, the creation of false news. I mean, a lot of these things are what is behind the electoral changes in America and Britain is actually the use of manipulation of media through new technology.
I'm going to have to stop you there, otherwise you're going to preempt the entire debate. Let me take that mic and pass it over to. Oh, you've got them as well. Brilliant. So you'll share that one. So Rosamund, you've heard. I mean, there seems to be agreement. You know that there is a kind of new disorder abroad. Whether how enduring it will be is a question that we'll come to later. But how dangerous and disorderly do you think the world is at the moment?
Well, I want to add two things that haven't quite been touched on. Max mentioned technology there. And of course, we've got a revolution coming. I keep writing about the robots are coming for our jobs and what that will mean for people. And part of that rage that we saw in America was people feeling their jobs being taken away. That is going to be accelerated quite clearly by what is coming. And when we talk about previous sort of revolutions on that scale in the workplace, they've actually increased the number of jobs in the long term. Some jobs have been lost, but they've been net producers. And the expectation from experts in that field is this is the first one where we've lost that. And the other thing we haven't looked at here is population changes.
Don't preempt the...
Okay, but that's obviously a big shift.
But, Max says, one of the issues is this dislocation you feel with new technology, and you're saying, in a sense, the technology is not just media technology, it's actual physical technology, robots. But that is a temporary dislocation, is what you're saying. I mean, the Luddites said the same thing would happen with spinning jennies, and actually they've delivered the fastest kind of economic growth the world has ever seen and enriched people across the globe. I mean, the net benefit is positive.
Well, we just simply don't know yet, do we? And I've read so many people writing on this, and the consensus seems to be that this will be the first time we lose jobs through this. Now, they could, of course, be wrong, and they've been wrong before, as you point out.
They've always been wrong.
Well, the doomsayers on it have always been wrong, but actually, when you look back, there were always, the flip side was there.
Well, there's periods of dislocation. But Ben, what do you think? I mean, do you give us this... The question was actually a measure of how dangerous and disorderly the world is. Your perspective is from arguably one of the most dangerous and disorderly nations on Earth, from Russia. Dangerous not internally, but externally.
I think it's interesting to answer the question not from my point of view, but from the point of view of the Russian president and of the Russian diplomatic corps. And in fact, this new world disorder, as we might see it, actually to them seems to be much more ordered and potentially much safer for their interests and the world than the last 15 or 20 years have been.
This is a bit rude. Can I interject and just say, to what extent do you think some of what's happening is being shaped deliberately by Russia?
Since the late 90s, the Russian president and the Russian diplomatic corps have pursued a vision of multipolarity in which they want the United States to respect civilizational boundaries, leave local strongmen alone, and allow the world to return to the sort of concert of powers in which regional hegemons will sort of divide the world up and meet in Yalta-like agreements.
And it's not just America, it's Europe as well.
Russia doesn't believe that the European Union is a genuine power system. It believes that Germany is a regional hegemon, and it refuses to sort of believe in these myths peddled by Western leaders. And the Russian leadership has been convinced, ever since the Kosovo War, that the danger to the world is American unipolarity, in which America sort of charges off on various crusades. And it now believes that having learnt its weakness, there'll be less of these wars and thus less disorder internationally.
I mean, you say it believes this, but actually what you're saying is a reflection of what it believes is in its best interest, surely. I mean, is that a belief, or is that like Russia needs to re-establish its rightful position in the world?
Definitely so, is the Russian leadership has long believed that even though it vacated technically the sovereignty of a former Soviet state, that these countries will be part of a sort of sphere of influence where they'll only be nominally independent and their foreign policy will be set by Moscow. And a lot of this is justification for that.
Re-establish that kind of the former, you know, empire, if you like. But let's kind of go back. So we've heard a kind of an outline of the territory that we're going to discuss there. But there is an argument that says, which says that the premise of the debate is false. And I mean, I know you talked about the coming apocalypse, Zafar, but a lot of people who voted Trump or voted Brexit would say this is a vote for order in a world that I perceive as disorderly. This is something you hinted at, Rosamund. They would say this is a vote for order, and actually they'd say, hold on, you know, you talk about a world disorder, I'm talking about an attempt to re-establish order. And there is definitely truth in that. There's definitely a sense of dislocation, as Max said, that people feel, and the response to that is voting for the strong leaders that you see as disorderly and dangerous.
Well, I mean, I think there's certainly no doubt that there's an economic dimension to why people voted for Trump, largely. I think there's an economic dimension to Brexit. And I think these two phenomena are, you know, in some ways, understandable responses to very real challenges and quandaries, you know, people face in their everyday lives. I think, though, there's sort of a greater issue here. Andrew Sullivan wrote a wonderful piece, I think it was in New York Magazine, some months before the election, where he talked about the fundamental danger to democratic systems was something which had been, you know, sort of prefigured by Plato, you know, a few thousand years ago, which was the possibility of the rise of a demagogue and how vulnerable we are to a demagogue coming in and taking over a sort of a democratic order. And he said that, and I do believe that, the rise of someone like Trump, in seeing the way he campaigned, the way he was very divisive in his rhetoric, the way he said that, look, you know, we're going to target and scapegoat certain communities, be it Muslims, be it immigrants, is actually very dangerous. I don't see that something like that actually will lead to greater order. I think it's inevitably going to lead to more fragmentation and more disorder. And if you look at it on the global scale, I mean, I understand that a lot of people are, of course, concerned and worried and anxious about the world in which we live, which is being more globalized by the day. You have more communities intermingling with one another. And of course, there are going to be certain people who find that worrisome, who find that not to their liking. However, I think to break down that order, and I think one of the things we're seeing both in England with the Brexit vote and in the US, which is also dangerous, is the absolute rejection of established norms, okay? The absolute rejection of any kind of notion of such a thing as a political establishment. I mean, in a sense, we're moving towards a very anarchist world, and I think, you know, while maybe some people think you need to sort of throw a bomb and blow it all up, I don't see how that can lead us to greater stability.
I mean, I can see that that is frightening if you believe in this idea that liberal democracy is the only way to run society and that, you know, free market capitalism is the only way that you can deliver economic growth. But what we're seeing, isn't it, is a reaction against this. And it's a popular reaction. So again, we come back to, you know, is the premise of the debate false? This is a popular reaction against democracy and capitalism, isn't it, Rosamund?
Well, one of the things you touched on was the idea of scapegoating, and I just happened to have written about that in relation to Trump, and obviously with an element of Brexit in there, that people found something to blame. And I think that's one thing chaos does, is it means people seek something to blame. And I think what we saw play out there was this quite across human history. We've always searched for people to blame for things. I happen to write about, I happen to study disease, and the common theme there is when an outbreak of disease comes, people find someone to blame. And I think what we will happen, and that obviously is a sort of catalyst towards further fragmentation, that what you see break down is any kind of bond that people have because they seek out somebody to be the scapegoat. And I think that's one of the really troubling things that we're seeing, the little current going through a lot of the different bits of what is happening all over the world.
I have to say, though, I mean, is the idea that, you know, politicians scapegoat people in order to, you know, build majorities behind them? There's nothing new in that, and indeed, there's nothing new in countries scapegoating each other.
There's nothing new. I mean, I said that there's nothing at all new. We've done it across human history. I mean, Jesus is a scapegoat. Probably the most obvious example. With disease, people blamed the Jews for the Black Death across Europe. I mean, there's all sorts of times when a sort of cataclysmic event hits and people always seek out someone to blame. What's interesting is that it's on both sides here, that it's helped cause that event, and then afterwards the repercussions, I think that's what we'll see there.
And the other theme that you brought up is this sense that there's a crisis of democracy. I mean, I think, again, that's interesting and open to kind of challenge. But, again, with your perspective from a country that's never properly embraced democracy, do you think there is, looking out? Do you think you also travelled America, reported on the Trump election. Is there a crisis in democracy, or is this a validation of the power of democracy to deliver a challenge to elites?
I think it's important when looking at Putin to understand this man had a political near-death experience. And in December of 2011, Putin was almost overthrown by large crowds gathering in Moscow, by serious divisions in the elites. And the reason that this took place is that Putin, when he, for several days before assuming the presidency in 1999, met all of the leaders of Russia's internet entrepreneurs and went, there'll be no China and no Vietnam on our internet. The FSB was very heavily lobbying him to follow the Chinese model and saying that the internet
the
was
FSB
a
serious... The FSB is effectively the KGB, isn't it?
The FSB is the domestic half of what the KGB
was. So it's the
was.
Internal security, the internal control system, spy system.
What we think of as the KGB, the sort of glamorous foreign agents, are now known as the SVR. And the domestic arm of Russian intelligence, is heavily lobbying to do something about the internet, to embed their power within the system. And Putin refused. He went, only 1% of the population is online. We could have done with something in the Soviet Union that allowed that top 1% to have access to the rest of the world's information. We'll just censor TV. We completely ignored the Russian internet, which became a very flourishing place. So in terms of business, or economics, Russians don't use Google, they use Yandex, they don't use Facebook, they use for contacting. And in December 2011, there was a protest movement organized on Facebook, fueled by Twitter, in which internet populists using leaks on corruption almost overthrew him. And what Putin decided is the internet is changing the way our politics works far more dramatically than he'd realized. And he began cloning all of the forces that had nearly overthrown him into a new format of Russian information war. This is where Kremlin trolls come from. This is where sort of a Russian information warfare technique that's now being beamed outwards was developed.
I mean, partly beamed from Russia, partly something that the internet itself has generated. And that obviously played a major role in Trump's election, didn't it?
Well, it did. And what is interesting is that Barack Obama, belittling his opponents, be they Trump or Putin, endlessly repeated that Putin is a creature from the 19th century, he doesn't understand. Obama was guest editing Wired magazine, as Putin was the one who was spending the most serious amount of time trying to understand how does the internet work and how do I manipulate it.
And arguably having more influence on the American election than virtually anybody else.
Well, quite, because Russia has developed a pretty cut-price and pretty effective way of spinning and stirring up sort of quivers and motions on the internet than the United States currently has. And right now you've got a lot of serious disquiet with both German intelligence and French intelligence warning that this information warfare will be deployed in both those upcoming elections.
So we've got quite a couple of themes there that speak to my original question, which was about what we're witnessing a breakdown of democracy, a breakdown of the consensus about liberal democracy as the central institution of states?
I don't think so. I think something that's interesting is, I mean, the role of Russia is fascinating, actually. In some ways, one wonders these days whether the Cold War is really over. And it's not just because Russia's being pushy, but in a sense, there's a kind of cultural war that's going on between two trends. I mean, America was always a very optimistic power. And it was always accused by the Russians of being naively optimistic when America marched into Lebanon in 1983, thinking that it would end the Civil War. Its Marines got blown up, when it marched into Iraq with optimistic ideas, stupidly, obviously, we all know that. There was a kind of naive optimism. There's an optimism in the whole American culture, including political culture. Russia's quite the opposite because of its historical experience with war, revolution, misery, concentration camps, gulags, et cetera, et cetera. Russia has a deeply dark, pessimistic, black outlook on things. And I sort of feel that 30 years after the end of the Cold War, it's that dark, bleak look which is becoming dominant in the world again. And it's just interesting to see that, I mean, if you look at the way that soft power was used by America as a natural extension of its entire self. Whereas with Russia, you have someone like Putin who's using soft power but in a very targeted, direct way by actually subverting the internet.
I mean, in that sense, there is a continuation of the Cold War. But if you look more widely, I mean, isn't one of the bigger trends that happening is a relative, not an absolute, but a relative decline in American power and a huge rise in the powers actually in the East, China, India, these great powers rising. And I wonder the disorder question, whether, you know, I mean, obviously there are writers that normally, writers writing from the West who write about, for example, Modi and talk about him as a disorderly, you know, as a part of a kind of wider kind of disorderly theme in society. But actually in India, you know, I think people don't perceive him like that. And actually, you know, there's a great new stability, if you like, in these powerful, growing economies of China and India and the whole region. Do you think that's true?
Well, I mean, it's interesting, and I think we have to split that question up in terms of sort of economic growth and other significant indicators. Now, when it comes to economic growth, the interesting thing is if you go back to the narrative of the 20th century, you could say that, you know, communism imploded of its own internal contradictions. But of course, the only way that liberal democracy defeated fascism was essentially on the battlefield. There's no one to say necessarily that that is a worse way to organize one society.
It only won on the battlefield. It didn't win in the marketplace.
Absolutely
well.
Not.
It didn't win by delivering, you know, delivering rising incomes to ordinary people.
Not at all. I mean, I think it, you know, if you're talking about the Second World War, that was actually won.
It won the Second World War on the battlefield, but subsequently it won the Cold War.
It won the Cold War against communism. It wasn't facing off against fascism in a Cold War. That was a hot war. And now I think if you see the rise of countries, which for want of a better word, if you look at China, for instance, and China is in no ways today can be seen as a communist country, for want of a better word. And I think fascism is perhaps the wrong word to use, but I think we all understand what we're talking about is a alternative to liberal democracy as a way to organize a country and an economy, and certainly it seems as though it can deliver economically. Now the question is at what cost, and I think the second question is if we are moving away from a unipolar world over the last 20 or 30 years into a sort of a multipolar world where you have certain regional hegemons and you have a more of a balance of power. And of course, in the aftermath of, you know, the Balkans in the Iraq war and, you know, the mess which is going on in the Middle East, I think it's very easy to make the argument that actually that would be no bad thing, which is clearly, I suppose, what the Russian and the Chinese point would be. However, I'm not so sure about that. I'm not sure that actually having a world order which is dominated by deeply illiberal figures in deeply illiberal regimes would actually be any good for most of the average men and women living in small countries around the world, who I think are going to be the big victims.
Well, there are two things there, aren't there? There's the rise of these great economic powers and the kind of, frankly, inevitability of a multipolar world, and then a separate question about who's running those powers and whether they are inherently disorderly. But it seems to me that there is no question that the idea, I mean, and this is the story of the 90s and into the early part of this century, was the end of American supremacy and the inevitability of the rise of a multipolar world. And I think it comes back to that theme that you picked up right at the beginning of an adjustment process to a new, and obviously a multipolar world is inherently likely to be more disorderly, isn't it? I mean, who wants to pick up on that?
Well, one thing we haven't touched on is that part...
Could we answer that?
The bigger story is I have a very deep naivete about globalization and almost sort of Marxist view that globalization was inevitably going to democratize and to morph authoritarians into being more like sort of Western liberals. And there's been a massive misunderstanding that in the 21st century, globalization actually makes life quite easy for a dictator in Kazakhstan or in Azerbaijan or in Russia, because they now have access to Western bankers, lawyers, accountants, PR artists, and lobbyists. And they can spend easily on a mass scale in Washington or in London or in Brussels for Westerners to undermine their own institutions. And if you look at an individual like Putin or Aliyev or Nazarbayev, I think they have a better sense of the possibilities globalization opens than a lot of our own leadership.
And is there another theme with globalization, which is that perhaps, you know, by delivering until fairly recently consistent economic growth, it's allowed the possibility for, you know, increasing material wealth of ordinary people, which means they're less likely to challenge political elites?
That's true. I want to get back to something that Ben was saying. I mean, isn't that an outcome of this sort of pessimism, you know, of people like Putin and so on? I mean, that they have a pessimistic worldview, which means that they want to go at this, you know, take control by using the same tools. And to go back to what I said,
I mean, they are authoritarian, so you know, inevitably they're going to want to use those the architecture of the state to try and sustain their power. So isn't it more interesting to ask whether or not there are other currents in the world that make it easier now than it was before? Because clearly there was a huge challenge to authoritarian power in 89 when the Berlin Wall fell and the collapse of the Soviet Union.
Yeah, I think it's because it was authoritarian power built on a particular ideology, which is communism, I mean, and held together by a glue that didn't work.
So but underneath it, there was an economic challenge. We're coming back to what we said then. There was an economic challenge to the power of the Soviet Union.
Sure, it collapsed by its own weight. It was a system that was not working.
Because they were trying to impose an
ideological framework onto things that don't fit into it. And it just didn't work.
And the miracle of China is you've got an authoritarian regime that recognizes the power of capitalism and creates freedom in the market space.
That's right. They're not trying to impose an arbitrary, you know, ideological framework on the economy. They sort of realize that these things have a natural growth.
Do you think the power of you know, the economic growth that we've seen in the last few decades has helped sustain, bizarrely, has helped sustain, you know, these authoritarian regimes?
Well, I think it's created instruments that they can use and that they've seized on because they have this worldview, which is very much how do we take control, rather than how do we ride these things to our profit. No, it's a profit in terms of, you know, public welfare. It's how do I and my little group take control using these tools. And certainly these tools have been created. And that's what I see as the problem. And if you look at somebody like Trump, he had an insight into how to use social media, how to use television, how to use the way that news is projected, that his insight gave him a great advantage over his opponent.
But he also, I mean, we talk about the media as if the media is overwhelmingly the most important thing. And actually, one of the messages from America was that the media, the traditional media, certainly all were, virtually without exception, were opposed to Trump, and it made absolutely no difference. Which suggests to me, Rosamund, I don't know if you agree with this, because again, you've written a lot about Trump and the election, whether actually he was tapping into this great dissatisfaction that, you know, that he just spoke to people who felt that they hadn't been listened to before. And there is this sense of dislocation and dissatisfaction in America, kind of despite unparalleled, you know, comparative wealth.
Yeah, I think some of those people might be deluded in that they haven't been listened to before. But yes, certainly a perception. And certainly he did capitalize on social media far, far better. I mean, I happened to look at how many followers Hillary Clinton had about a month before the election on Twitter. And I was stunned that she hadn't done more before. And when she launched it, you know, she actually was very late joiner to Twitter, and you know, it was quite a big thing at the time, written about it. But it's really Facebook that's much more powerful. Journalists fixate on Twitter because it's our medium. But Facebook obviously was incredibly powerful and didn't really look at the way. I mean, Mark Zuckerberg has sort of dismissed the idea that it played any role in this election. But it did two things, not just the propagation of fake news, but it actually helped get all their online fundraising. And that money influx, I mean, people obviously kept writing that Hillary Clinton was massively outspending Trump on TV, basically. But Trump's campaign actually looks incredibly savvy when you analyze it from the perspective of him having won, obviously. You've got the advantage there. But it was their biggest incubator. It got them all this money. I think it was $250 million that they raised from that. And that, I think, is fascinating because he capitalized on that in a very clever way and without anyone really quite noticing until afterwards.
He certainly did, but I'm sorry to come back to the theme of, I'm quite interested in this sense of dissatisfaction and dislocation that so many people in the Western, I think we need to make a comparison between the Western world and the rest of the world, but in the Western world, it feels like most of the disorder to me is actually focused around America, Europe, and Russia, and the Middle East. But actually in Asia, we're seeing something very different happening. And what I find bizarre and slightly paradoxical is that actually, you know, incomes have steadily been rising in places like America. Britain isn't, you know, has not been doing badly compared to other European countries. And yet clearly there's this kind of anger and frustration about, you know, about society.
Well, yeah, let's sort of get stuck in there. Well, firstly, we talk often about how global incomes are rising. The global economy is getting bigger. Capitalism has made people much wealthier over the last 20 years. Now, if you actually break down who's getting what, there's a U graph in which people in poor countries are getting richer. The rich people in rich countries are getting richer, but the people who are doing the least well and whose incomes have actually gone down are poor and lower middle class people in rich countries. Now, if you zoom in and you go to these places, you go to small town Pennsylvania, you go to the north of England or eastern France, if you look at these places, again, you think, well, the statistics don't quite add up. Unemployment is lower than it's been before, and by a lot of measures, their wages have simply been stagnant. If you like look behind that, you find that people's job structures have changed. And whereas their parents or their sort of elder brothers and sisters had had stable wage, sort of 10-year-long jobs for life, uberized and they've been reduced to a precariat. So even though on average on a year they might earn as much as a factory worker, they don't have any sense of stability that they did before. And then there's been another change, which is how people relate to their colleagues. And this is also very interesting in terms of immigration and integration, which is that where in the sort of previous proletariat setup you had mass jobs with lots of colleagues, in today's sort of gig economy precariat setup, you're often working alone or with two or three other people. And that's
so there's a kind of lonelier, less secure world that many of the former kind of middle and working class people in Europe were feeling.
People who are insecure professionally are much more vulnerable to any discourse about any discourse about jobs.
I just want to throw this to you, Zafar, because that is part of what's happening there is surely the kind of rise of these great economies in the East, which are challenging, and there's obviously outsourcing maybe has played out, a lot. But there's a challenge from the East. As the world becomes, frankly, more equal between nations, you see some of this dislocation being driven by that. Do you think that's right?
I mean, I think that's true. I think Max mentioned this when he talked about, a lot of this is dislocation, which is going to come, is a natural consequence of, globalization as well as a rising tide in previously, lesser developed parts of the world. I mean, I think it is more difficult for people to, people in sort of industrial areas in the West to now compete. And I think the interesting thing is, though, of course, is what we're seeing increasingly is, working class jobs, or what were traditionally thought of as working class jobs, have been in decline for many years, for many decades now in the West.
And it seems rising here.
They're rising, but it's interesting. I think what's going to a more interesting element to me is I think that middle class jobs are becoming more and more scarce on the ground. And of course, once upon a time you figured that you could move your factories to Mexico or China or Bangladesh or wherever, and then that was done. Then people figured out that they could move their back office. Next they're going to figure out that they can move their, they can do their legal and accounting work. And who knows? I mean, why couldn't you have an Indian or a Singaporean CEO come? And a lot of CEOs, in fact, in Fortune 500 companies are Indian.
But more frightening still is the thing that you raised right at the beginning, and I tried to squash you there, was the rise of the robots. That the next challenge comes, to all economies. Yeah. China is now the biggest investor in robotic technology, because as wages rise in China, people recognize the way to deliver the cheap goods that have been the basis of Chinese growth is to mechanize. And that is a really frightening prospect for people. I don't want to, again, come back to the whole Luddite debate. But
Can I add something, though, about economic insecurity? Because, and this is specifically about the Brexit vote, we've seen in Britain there's been a rise in what's known as intergenerational inequality. So people, for the first time, feeling that they won't have the lives their parents had, there's a sort of natural belief that you will get, that things are getting better. And what's interesting about the Brexit vote is that actually young people overwhelmingly voted to stay in the European Union. So the people most affected by this idea of economic insecurity, the people in the gigs economy, as it's known, where you have four jobs and you don't see colleagues, you're sitting at home with a laptop. So those people did not vote for Brexit in overwhelming numbers. In fact, they did the exact opposite. Now, part of that is a generation shaped by coming into the workplace during an economic crisis. But I think, so they wanted stability, and I think that really was quite common. But it's not as simple as being about economic security. There is a cultural thing there, and I think to reduce it to that is a mistake, because when you look at it, so the people overwhelmingly who voted to leave were the baby boomers who've actually done quite well out of life. And I think it's a mistake to reduce it to that, because it doesn't look at the broader
picture. No, that's interesting. Well, we've got another debate. this afternoon on Brexit, where we'll be exploring some of these themes in more detail. But coming back to that point that there is an existential threat actually to the rise of these economies in the East as well, I mean, how worried are you? The rise of the robots, is that now a new challenge, a new disorder that's going to destroy the working classes, the middle classes in Asia as well as in Europe?
I think that the thing that I'm really worried about and I'm researching at the moment is over the last 30 years, you have seen a declining capacity of Western states to have access to tax, to have access to their tax base and to have influence over wealth. And there has been a boom of free, because of the following free trends, you've had the development of instantaneous money transfer, you've had the end of capital controls, you have the boom of the wealth defense industry. We now have a situation where in Europe, between 10 and 20% of money is held offshore. It's not taxed. Government doesn't know where it is, it's anonymous, money doesn't have access to it. In Africa and in Russia, the percentage of money which is offshore is 30 and 40%. And so you have increasingly large amounts of capitals that are the state can't have access to. So if you look at just one example, which is the UK, there is more money in UK tax havens. This is a stock, not a flow, than there is in the entire average UK GDP a year. And this money is not being taxed. There's no access to it. For the tax base, for the larger extent. And I think that's for me, that's very interesting. Is if you read about like the development of state power and books by sort of Charles Tilly and such, states empower themselves through basically tax, being able to sort of take control of finance in a society. And one of the trends of the last 30 years is a diminution of that.
It's a bit rude to challenge your. I would challenge that on the basis that actually the majority of taxes raised through indirect and income taxes, and what you're talking about is exploitation of tax loopholes by the elite. And actually, you know, the broad tax base hasn't changed that much, and ordinary people don't use, clever scams to hide their tax.
As a percentage of the wealth within a society.
Yeah, but that's partly reflects growing inequality and the concentration of wealth at the top. And so, interestingly, what you're seeing in places like India, which has a tiny tax base, 1% of Indians pay income tax. What you see, this effort, demonetization, is a great drive, a symbolic drive. We could discuss that, but let's not. Again, a great symbolic drive by Modi to try and draw people into the tax base and force Indians to pay tax, and then releasing that revenue for India to invest in the economy, which, you know, you could see is a good thing. So there is scope for other countries to actually draw more people possibly into the tax base. But it's
been a very different situation from Indian oligarchs or British oligarchs 30 years ago, how much of their wealth was taxed and under the supervision of the government than there is today.
No, I'm sure that's right.
Another really major trend is that if you look at the world economy today, you have trillions of dollars travelling the world incognito, which simply wasn't the case 30 years ago because the tax haven sort of parallel financial system was much, much smaller.
And that's the diminution
of the power of the state.
That is, and it's also, I mean, the globalization of the economy has represented a flow of power away from national governments historically over the last 20 or 30 years. So national governments are less able to influence their economies and make decisions, and partly isn't Trump and Brexit partly a reaction against the fact that all governments look the same, because actually governments can't make as much difference as they used to in the world. Do you think that's fair, Max?
Yes and no. I think in terms of economically speaking, that's very true. And I think Trump, though his ideology is he'd be entirely in favor of governments having less and less influence over all of this. He thinks it's wonderful. But in terms of the capacity of governments, I mean, they have a capacity for...
Yeah, in theory, he says that, but actually he talks about, you know, reviving. He talks about reviving, you know, the Rust Belt of America and stuff like that. That sounds to me like potentially a very... nobody really knows, do they? A very interventionist policy.
I think in practice it couldn't possibly be because of their ideological, you know, where they stand from as
the Republicans,
free marketers.
But Trump, I think, you know, we can't be certain what he actually thinks he can do.
He can put up barriers. I mean, he's going to be more interventionist in terms of trade, but he thinks that it doesn't hold up, frankly.
I mean, I
think what Ben was saying about the concentration of capital. I mean, we talked a lot about globalization, but globalization unfortunately has been accompanied by this tremendous concentration of capital.
Well, and this is about global. I'm sorry to pick up that theme again, but this is about global inequality, and this is about elites exploiting tax loopholes. I mean, it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, as I said before, I mean, governments can still raise income from the vast majority of people. So there are bits of income which should be taxed, and people are quite rightly angry that it's not being taxed. But I'm not sure I completely agree that this is a massive change in the power of governments.
I was moving away from that, but just talking in general about the concentration of capital. Let's put us in an unprecedented place. I mean, you know, this big fat book by Thomas Piketty. I mean, he's actually quite right about this historic drift towards capital accumulating more and more and more and more in fewer hands. And that is really, in some ways, if you sort of scratch very deeply, that is at the root of the malaise in a lot of places, that people feel disempowered because they've got muck jobs. Because the way that the modern capitalism is working is not generating welfare for the middle classes anymore. That's very true. But also, it's dangerous because there's too much money. I mean, there's too much capital out there. It's sloshing around all over the place. And this is what caused the disequilibrium of the crash in 2008. There's too much capital, so it gets thrown into stupid things. You know, too much capital and not enough places to put it that are safe. You know. That's one of the deep logic, underlying
the economic logic of that would be that money would be destroyed if there's more capital than there is, you know, things of value in the world, you would expect that capital to be destroyed, wouldn't you?
It just goes into silly things. It goes into silly things, and values of things get very distorted. And what you have is a situation where you get a serious misallocation of capital. I mean, capital in the world is not really going to a lot of places that it really ought to go to. I mean, places like, and it's partly because of the, that also has to do with the instability in a lot of places. But I mean, there's no shortage of money now for investment in virtually anything. It just has to be, it has to get there. And that's the trouble.
Yeah, I can't say, I mean, if money's being invested in things that don't return value, then you would expect that money to be destroyed. You'd expect that investment to be lost. And, you know, be picky, but I can't see the economic logic of that. It must be investing in productive enterprise, otherwise they'd lose money and the capital would be destroyed.
Sure, you're correct, but I mean, I'm just saying that it gets tossed into things like, you know, hysterically rising real estate prices in funny places.
But even the global financial crisis did not destroy. You know, the house prices in America, in London, I'm not sure about Paris, it may have done in Paris, but you know, around the world, you know, property prices, which were considered the consumer bubble, if you like, did not burst as a result of it. In fact, people poured wealth into property.
Yes, but it did turn into a bubble it did burst, actually. I mean, it did burst in a bubble, and the money poured into instruments that they shouldn't have, you know, because people are greedy for returns and because there's too much money out there looking for, you know, it's too liquid. I mean, and we may still see, I mean, China is now in potentially in the biggest bubble ever seen. You know, we don't know what's going to happen with China right now. There's too much money.
People have been saying that about China for a long time, obviously, and I mean, it will be interesting to see how that plays out. But I wanted to move on. We kind of, you know, drawing with two-thirds of the way through. So we've been talking a lot about what happened, but a little bit of historical analysis. Let's look forward into the future, find out how pessimistic people are. I'm going to save you for later. Rosamund, how pessimistic are you about this new world disorder?
Well, I've tended to always fall on the positive side. We live longer, we're healthier, with some caveats about lifestyle. But actually, the last year has been a very bad year to be an optimist. And I think something that I've looked into a lot is the impact of demographic population changes. And one of the massive shifts that we have obviously seen that naturally comes with it, plenty of disorder, is this migratory shift. But also, we've gone from sort of in 1950, about 6 of the 10 most populous countries were in the developed world, and now we will have just 2, which will be Russia and America, the US. And that's a massive shift. And I think that's one thing that is worth looking at, that gives me great grounds for pessimism, because not that particular shift, but the sheer numbers. So we are fairly close to hitting 8 billion people. We will keep going beyond that. And there is a question of how many people the Earth can take, the idea of carrying capacity that we have probably long exceeded. And that, I think, is something that gives me sort of great fears. Perhaps there are going to be too many of us And that's something that will create a great deal of disorder.
Ben, disorder, fears for the future?
I think that fears of international anarchy and clashes of empires are probably over-exaggerated. I wouldn't want to be a small state bordering a regional hegemon, but I think talk of sort of World War III is sort of wildly over-exaggerated. I think that we're going to move into quite a tumultuous period in domestic politics of Britain, France, Germany, or any economy that doesn't have over 60 or 70% dependent on the state. So I think, ironically, the Russian economy will be more stable, and there are three trends here that I think are quite interesting. The last 20 years have been the unmaking of the working class. A lot of what's happening is the wages of that. I think the next 20 years will be dominated by the unmaking of the middle class. A few trends here. The first is coming mass automation. Anybody who works in the car industry will tell you that here, 10, 15 years, cars will mostly be automated, and certainly haulage will be. But the most common job in most US states is actually being a trucker. Second trend is the end of the professions and how jobs like accountants, lawyers are already being eaten away by online sort of apps such as TurboTax in the United States, which kill the high street accountant. And the third trend is the end of home ownership. And this is more driven by the actual structures of finance than it is by flows of international money. And in the UK, 70% of bank lending takes place to property, only 8% of it actually goes in lending to business, the rest is lending to other banks. So we're moving into a situation where you have a whole generation which feels itself to be culturally middle class, but doesn't have any of the security of being middle class. I think that will make fine terrain for populists of the left or of the right.
And do you think this is, because what you're describing is very sounds to me very much like a Western perspective. Do you think this applies elsewhere in the world as well?
I would be extremely worried about 3D printing if I was planning social stability in Asia. And as long as you don't have that, I think you can probably keep these industrially based social orders relatively stable.
And what about you? I mean, how optimistic are you? Are you worried about, you know, the collapse?
I think it'll take a long time, but I think, you know, getting back to my original statement, what Ben said, I mean, it certainly sounds somewhat apocalyptic to me, because I mean, if the world's population is going to, I think the last estimate I see, it's going to level off around 11 billion, as you had mentioned, and that's an awful lot of people, and at the same time, we're not creating enough jobs for all of the people. In fact, we're losing jobs. This is a big problem, of course, we have in a country like Bangladesh, is that, you know, we are growing leaps and bounds, you know, 7% economic growth, but somehow we can still not create enough jobs every year for all of the people who are entering the job market.
And this that's echoed elsewhere. There's very similar problems in India as well, where
absolutely.
You've got quite dramatic economic growth, but jobless growth. And it's really hard to see how you can get around that.
And there's, there's other issues which we really haven't at all touched upon, which is, you know, and again, in a country like Bangladesh, climate change is, of course, a matter of huge importance. And, of course, the fact that one is to believe his public statements, you know, Donald Trump does not actually believe in this. He's looking to pull the U.S. out of the Paris Agreement. So this is actually, we have a sort of a global consensus on this issue, which has been, you know, actually not really done nearly enough to ward off catastrophe. If we're going to tear all of that up, I think that is something extremely worrisome for all of us, more worrisome perhaps for us here in Bangladesh, which is a low-lying country, absolutely on the front lines of climate change. And then the third issue which I worry about, of course, which I think is tied into the rise of Trump, is that, you know, with his anti-Muslim rhetoric, what it does is it, of course, gives succor and comfort to Islamic radicals, militants, and it makes a sort of a counter-narrative, makes a counter-argument saying that, well, look, you know, what we really need to do is we really need to just develop ourselves and grow, which is, you know, what you see here in Bangladesh. I think that's the government's message. It starts becoming less attractive. It starts becoming less persuasive to people who look and say, well, you know, if, you know, this world is ruled by the U.S. and this kind of a person can be elected president in a democratic election, maybe, you know, what the militants are saying about the evils of the Western world and the neo-colonial, neo-imperialist world order, maybe it's all true. Maybe, you know, we shouldn't try and make an accommodation with a world like this, and the only way to actually approach it, the only moral position, is to, you know, go to war against it. I think it makes things extraordinarily difficult for those of us in a country like Bangladesh.
I'm being a little bit unfair to Max. We're going to open up to a very quick question and answer session in a moment. I'm being a little bit unfair to Max, because I'm assuming
Now, you're going to kind of say, look, hold on, kind of people worried about the rise of the robots years ago, and actually this is, like as you said right at the beginning, this is a period, an unsettling period, the rise of new superpowers, the beginning of a multipolar world. You'd expect there to be disorder, but the history of the world suggests to us that human beings are actually quite good at coping. Are you along those lines, or are you going with the apocalypse theme?
No, I more or less along those lines. I felt like I have to counterbalance all this wave of darkness that's coming from the other side of the stage. One thing is that, Zafar, actually, there's as a matter of interest, there's a new study on population that looks much more accurate than the 11 billion figure. Okay. They're now saying that it's more likely to be 9 billion because they hadn't calculated. It's much better because we're already at 7.
There is good news.
We're already at 7 billion, yeah. But I mean, because they hadn't calculated properly how quickly countries start to decline. Bangladesh being a leading example, although Dhaka will be the world's biggest city, which is a bit disturbing. But I just want to say that in terms of disruption, what we're really talking about is a very disruptive period, and I'm sure that's true, and it's particularly true for Western countries. But I think the experience of places like Bangladesh or India, for example, for that matter, other places where I've worked, is that I don't think that life will necessarily be more disruptive. I mean, countries like Bangladesh or India or China or most of Africa or all of the Middle East have already been living in massive disruption. I mean, in fact, most of the world has been extremely disrupted. And one of the reasons why the West looks so peculiar now is that they're beginning to experience the same turbulence that other people have had for a long time.
That's a very good, on that note, sorry, can I throw it open to the audience? Because I have left it rather late because I found this also fascinating. Guy in the middle there, do you want to just try and project to us and we'll see if we can hear you rather than wait for a mic?
Wealth. I repeat my question, that when we learn that 84 billionaires of the world owns wealth, which if 50% of the world population doesn't own, don't you think this great inequality of accumulation of capital is creating the disorder?
That is a really good question. I was actually yesterday, this is a little bit of a name drop, I was with Bill Gates, the richest man in the world, and he owns, by chance, 86 billion is the current value of his net wealth. Rosamund, inequality is a huge issue here, isn't it?
So I name dropped back. I've
go on, counter name drop.
Interviewed Bill Gates twice, and I interviewed him last month. What one source of hope from Bill Gates would be that he's going to give his wealth away. He doesn't want his children to inherit massively, and he's encouraging other billionaires to do that. Now, that is a change, because in Britain, so the Duke of Westminster died recently. He's a massive landowner in London, and the wealth just went to his, I think, 24-year-old son, who's now, obviously, Tatler magazine, a society magazine, thinks he's the most eligible man in our country. But there is a progressive thing there, which if it trickles down to other billionaires, we could be a little bit hopeful about, because I feel I've been incredibly pessimistic on this panel. And given that he's encouraged people like Warren Buffett and other people to sign up to this and to give it away in a good way to good philanthropic causes, get eradicating polio, okay. That sort of thing.
Yeah, so cause you for build, hope. Build your wealth and then build your legacy. Another question, please. Yep.
Disorder might, be a prelude to an order. Think of the superstar philosopher, Slavoj Žižek, said that, he endorsed Trump at the last moment. And he said that, you need destruction for construction. And we can see it in terms of Democratic Party might be a social democratic, yep. Social democracy.
Excellent.
And also Corbyn might be in power.
That's a very good point. I'm not going to you, Max, because you've already done that one. But Ben, what do you think?
I do think that in Britain and in
creative
the US,
destruction, that's the force of capitalism, isn't it?
I think he's a sort of charlatan just on the level of Trump as a performer, and he unendorsed him.
Forget the specifics. Answer the question.
I do think that the left in Britain and in the US has been written off way too early. And I think that these sort of nativist right-wing causes winning election on the back of what are effectively social democratic promises is actually paving the way for...
Yeah, but his question was actually, there is a force of destruction which can be creative. Are you saying that that's creative in that it kind of revives the left, or what do you say?
Well, I'm more conservative than that, so I wouldn't be in favour of that.
Okay.
I don't believe in creative destruction in that way, but I do think that both of these victories could open the way for more left-wing politics down the road.
Right, could we take another question? There's somebody at the back. Can I take the lady at the back? No, not you. The lady behind you, and then I'll come to you. Sorry. Wait, the mic's coming to you. I can't hear you, so I'm sure that...
From Asia Literary Agency. There's a lot of talk here on this panel, this very Western panel, and from a Western, you know, perspective about the new global world order and you know, equality and democracy, etc. And you know, de Tocqueville noted that the overriding but more intangible danger facing democracies is the simply their love for equality, which will lead to despotism, either in the hands of the majority or of a minority. Do you think that that is a problem, that you know, we believe that equality is the end-all, be-all, when in fact it isn't?
Yeah, I think, let me put that to you. Do you, I mean, do you see this assumption, this underlying assumption of democratic societies that everybody's equal and therefore should have equal weight in terms of their say and who governs them? What Mill describes as the dictatorship of mediocrity. But do you think that's a worry? Mm-hmm. I mean, actually, it's a bizarre question in a sense to ask about Bangladeshi, because this is a very unequal society, isn't it?
Right. No, but I mean, I think, you know, regardless of the recent election of Trump and, you know, the way people voted, I think most people, well, you know, the question is to ask is whether this is a better way, whether democracy is a better way of organizing one's economy and one's society than others, regardless of the fact that, you know, people may be unequal. There's inequalities of wealth, there's inequalities of education, there's inequalities of understanding. But I think I think Amartya Sen is the person who said that he saw, you know, sort of, you know, democracy itself in and of itself is a good.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why it's such an enduring form of government. Let me quickly come to you. I'm rushing because I know we're near the end, and there's one last theme I want to bring up before we finish. So give us your question, if you could.
Good afternoon. People are reluctant from showing humbleness, and it takes morality, and they have become more mechanical. And they're emphasizing on survival of the fittest. My question is, how can humanity, morality, be restored as things are getting pretty much deplorable?
I love it. That's a great question for you, Max.
Well, I have a very simple way. If people would just listen to me, then...
I've given them the opportunity, Max.
we'd have no problem at all. And unfortunately...
By the Economist.
Too many people believe that, obviously. But restoring morality is not easy. Not easy at all.
Do you think there's been a breakdown in morality?
No, I don't think. I don't think the world is. I mean, and it's interesting. You know, another book that was kind of seminal when it came out a few years ago. I'm trying to remember Pinker, Thomas Pinker.
Yeah, another I remember that.
P book. Yeah, P author. About he did a historical study looking at how many people were killed and how over thousands of years, and discovered that actually we're getting nicer and nicer and nicer. If you measure it by how many people die by violence in the world is actually, believe it or not, becoming a nicer place.
And Rosamund, you picked up on a number of other indicators, lifespan, you know, people are living longer, their average wealth is higher, so there are lots of positive things.
There's much to be said for that. It's just that in some ways the capacity for destruction gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and also the capacity to advertise destruction gets bigger and bigger. So we have a phenomenon like Daesh, ISIS, and half of their destructiveness, or perhaps much more than half, is actually about publicity and their skill at manipulating imagery rather than their actual destructive power.
Because on those statistics, actually fewer people are dying of terrorist attacks now than were, you know, 20 years ago. I think that's right.
I mean, it depends year to year.
Let me just, I've got one last thing that I wanted to throw into the pot, so I'm going to be greedy now. We've practically run out of time. I just wanted to say, look, it's a very negative, we have overall been quite negative about all of this, but it strikes me there's another way. I know, I'm really sorry. We're out. You have to. Oh, well, then then we're going to have to run over. I'm sorry.
The despair of the followers of Donald Trump has very little to do with economics, or it does have a lot to do, but not that much. But with their feeling left out as a race.
I think,
their
to be fair,
their way of life, their culture, everything is. Has taken second place.
I think Ben did address a bit of that. But let me just pick up, can I just finish this on one thought, which it seems to me, and maybe this is just because I'm a journalist, but it seems to me there is more disorder. We do live in uncertain times, and all the things that we've talked about are evidence of that. But in a sense, isn't that exciting? You know, doesn't it make the world a more interesting and exciting place? Doesn't it also give you more to fight against, to fight for? Doesn't it increase passion, make you more passionate, believe in politics again, believe in the ability of all of you, of all of us to make change? And isn't that, in a sense, we all talk about this, oh, this disaster, but in a sense, there is a kind of, you know, and something that enlivens you and gives you a sense of kind of, a kind of sense of excitement about being alive at this time. What do you guys think? Do you agree with that, or is that just sophistry?
That you've got these huge international problems such as tax havens or climate change, and up until now it's been the consensus that they can only really be tackled through a hegemonic international order guaranteed by the United States. And if we're moving away from that, one of the things I'm tense about is whether or not you can get that kind of great power cooperation.
Good point.
So many of my colleagues said exactly that about Trump's the day before we were all discussing it and said, but it's going to be more fun if he wins as a journalist. And I thought that was a form of insanity. For me, particularly, I think there would have been a great thing of having a woman. I get that many people may find Hillary Clinton a deeply flawed candidate. Personally, I didn't. But there would have been something really positive in what was stirred up for women. And I think that could have been a really great force.
Well
and it
said.
Didn't happen. And I was...
Well said.
Okay.
Hold on. Let me just, because you edit a national newspaper.
Yeah.
You know, you are in the business of news. I mean, you must have looked at this and gone, come on, guys, you know, let's get reporting.
No, I think I agree. It's not necessarily, it's fun. Of course, it keeps us in business. But I think more to the point, you know, I was reading after the election in America, you know, these, you know, people, you know, there's a lot of gnashing of teeth and, you know, rending of garments, saying, what are we going to tell our children? I mean, I was like, no, what do you mean, what are you going to tell your children? You tell your children what, you know, I already tell my children. We know that there's inequality. We know that there's injustice in the world. I mean, it's amazing that people are just now waking up to this with Trump's election. But I mean, for me, it doesn't, that element of it has not fundamentally changed. And we're all in here, you know, trying to fight the good fight, doing what we do. You know, whether Trump is elected, whether the UK had voted to stay in the EU or not, it does make things, I mean, I'm not excited by it in the way you suggested, but it certainly enthuses me, you know, to get out of bed and fight that fight every day. And I think, you know, the other thing which we should never forget is that nothing is, you know, I think we've been talking about an apocalyptic worldview, but it may seem that I'm saying that it's inevitable, but I think nothing is inevitable. After all, the election was extraordinarily close, and if it had gone a few points the other way, we'd all be saying something very different.
Max, are you thrilled and excited by this new world disorder?
Well, I must say that I have both American and British nationality, and Brexit made me very happy to be living on another continent, and Trump's election made me very, very happy to be about as far as America, from America as possible.
And you've left the Middle East for India
in Delhi,
as well.
That's so. Right, exactly. So, yes, I don't really have much to add there.
Okay. Well, that, I mean, as you saw, we're being told that we've overrun, which was a great shame because we really could have continued this forever. Thank you very much for coming and listening to this debate. It was great fun to do. Thank you.